here and use them again. And the exhibition we are about to view is devoted to Fauve Landscape painting, a phase in the history of art from 1905 to 1908. It was led by a group of young painters who produced canvases so simplified in design and so shockingly brilliant in color that they startled the critics, the public, and the entire art world. And three groups of artists dominated this period. The first, Saint of Ireland, Andrew Mathis, the eldest and most well-known. Charles Connery, Andrew Mando, Abel Mathieu, Jean Poole, and Louis Vanity, who all studied with Mathis in Paris in the 1890s. The second group consisted of Andrew Dolly and Maurice de Vermeer, who resided in the Chateau, a suburb of Paris, and Georges Braque, Raoul Dufour, and Otto Fiers made up the third group who went in England. As you will see, each group style differed, of course, but one fundamental element linked them together indelibly. They provoked, they assaulted, they shook the world. Obvious rebellion was there, and more importantly, wildness. So wild that one inspired critic called them Fauve, which in French means wild beast. The expression cut immediately and effervescent was born. Miss Judy Freeman, curator of 20th century art at the Los Angeles County Museum, will now present a selection of the works of these brilliant artists that are detailed, precise commentaries. Let us listen.
Wild beasts from Vietnam and the Americas. They were daring and inventive and encouraged by the newly discovered exotic arts of Africa and the South Pacific. Through their liberated use of fashion, pure colors, and novel, unattractive shapes, they changed the face of painting well into the century. The Fauve artists paired off in different geographic locations. We will still do these sites as we view the work of a short-lived yet highly innovative period of art history, where the subject was as important as the interplay of color. Zaman showed an enthusiasm for painting the bridges across the Seine in the small towns northwest of Paris. They frequently ran the river's banks in search of enchanting new paintings to capture on their canvases. Blondeck was strongly influenced by Vincent van Gogh. In this painting, the thick, full brush work that was formed standing on the bridge was very similar to van Gogh's use of paint. In this painting, Durand used thickly applied brush strokes and organized zones of color to capture the bustle of activity around the walls and the bridge. The local villagers would spend the afternoon sailing, sewing, and even washing and laundering the riverbank. Here too, Dylan applied his paint in a similar fashion. The pale white in the river is set with thick, small while the surrounding tones of color faded in a green.
I must tell you that Chateau, Lopec, and Bougival were delightful little villages 100 years ago, still untouched by the Industrial Revolution, by rivers and brooks as yet unpolluted. And as I and Jamaica lived for people. But they also lived for a living. They were both exaggerated, extravagant, supercharged human beings. Highs and lows were constant with them, particularly the year when Louis' life was prone to periods of acute depression. But even the lows he left to be felt by Louis first was painting with his friend, dreaming, bicycle riding, trips and boats, swimming together in the rivers and brooks around the countryside, and enjoying to the fullest the wine they drank, the food they ate, and the women they made love with, etc. and such. Sensualist giants they were. And it is themselves that they painted through splash of raw color straight out of the tube, whether it was a bridge, a tree, or a barge, it was this explosive vitality that they fought.